Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning. I'm so glad you're here today. So glad. So my title this morning, when I stop popping, is My Destiny is Growing Me. And I don't know where that came from. I'm not sure if I read it. Maybe I even thought it up myself. I'm not sure. But I found it on a notepad on my very abundantly paper-piled desk. And there it was, and I thought, well, there, that's the perfect talk title. So wherever it came from, I really like it. And I like anything that reminds me that there is something greater happening than we might think if we just look from our five-sense world. I love anything that really brings me back to remembering that we are so, so much more than what is contained in these sort of human body packages that we display here on this earthly plane. Because there is more to us than our human sensing, feeling, or thinking. We are connected, and we are actually even more than connected. We are one with the infinite creative mind of the universe. And this mind that we are at one with is love, it is intelligence, it is complete, it is perfect. And it is satisfied and at peace with itself. So it, that it thing, is what animates our lives. And whether we know it or not, that greater something is supporting us and moving us forward in our evolution toward our greater yet to be. It's already within us, and it is moving us forward. And yet sometimes I think, because you know, we focus a lot on our individuality and our personal life experience, that maybe we don't always keep that knowing of that infinite greater wisdom front and center. And because of that, maybe we sometimes fall into the thinking that we, that small I self, has the power. And that we, solely from our own linear, logical, ego thinking, have 100% control of our lives. And for sure, while it's true that this greater intelligence is us from that larger, most cosmic sense, if we think that we access it only by using our personality, human thoughts to create our lives, I think we're missing the bigger picture and maybe even setting ourselves up for disappointment. Because, well, I don't know about you, but I cannot help but look out into the world and see lots and lots of things that don't really seem to be under my control. And so for me, you know, I can't control who walks into these doors on a Sunday morning. Because if I could, I'd fill this place to overflowing, so we'd have to have video screens someplace else to have them. I can't control the people around me to act like I want them to, which is a real bother. I haven't figured out, nor apparently has anybody else yet, figured out how to fix the government, or climate change, or how to eradicate war, or hunger. And you know, if it was only up to me, or really only up to having a positive thought about all those things, I for sure would have done all of that, and then some. So perhaps why this apparent limitation is still pretty prevalent is because we're so tightly tied to the world that we can see, that we can feel, that we can touch, and we can hear. We're tightly tied to what is out there. You know, so much of our societal viewpoint is still attached to that world of form, and wanting physical proof and scientific evidence from that kind of Newtonian physics point of view. And so I think we've created that tendency to kind of rely on our human thinking, the world of science and form, to figure things out. And just maybe, it's time to move on to a higher order of being and to realize that if this is where we've been working from, perhaps we are using and operating from only a tiny, tiny portion of what is possible and truly available to ourselves, both in the global sense and from that point of view of our own life experiences. So that's what I want to look at today, and part of that is I'm going to take a little bit of a chance and be what feels kind of vulnerable, because I'm sure that you think that anybody who is a minister speaking up here on the stage has all of her stuff together by now. Not so much. But I want to share in hopes that maybe you'll relate, and also with the idea that perhaps it'll create a space for all of us to be more authentic as well. So I've noticed that I'm finding it a challenge personally to be doing more and more of these Sunday talks on a regular basis. And it's uncomfortable for me in a couple of ways. And yet, you know, simultaneously, I also deeply, deeply know that it is exactly the right thing to be happening, because it is happening. And it's really been a great growth opportunity for me, because it's given me a chance to do a lot of a deeper internal reflection about it. So part of the challenge is I am so darned aware of my own nature, and I know that I am so much happier kind of being behind the scenes. My comfort zone is that I'm happy doing the organizational pieces, the administrative things, and I'm really thrilled to just be able to set the stage for whatever or whoever wants to happen. Don't get me wrong, I love this teaching. I love sharing the ideas of Science of Mind, and I adore things like teaching classes. But being the focal point and kind of the center of attention up here, knowing all you look exactly here and I'm the only one, it's like, not so much, not so much. Also, preparing the messages has been a little bit of a struggle, because from that place of my small mind, that ego, personality, self, I figure I've pretty much told you everything I know. Done. But, I mean, remember a couple Sundays ago, we had that 1,040th Sunday service, and I mentioned that we've had 1,040 messages since our inception 20 years ago. And I figured out, more or less, Ken has probably done like maybe 980 of them, and I have brand new respect for him. And if you take out a few that have been done by guest speakers and staff ministers over the year, I myself have probably done, give or take, about 60 talks or so. And in my mind, as I'm preparing during the week, what goes through my head is, you know, I have shared everything that I know. I have shared everything I've got to say. Because really, how many ways are there to say, change your thinking, change your life? Love, peace, and joy are possible, and we're here to maximize our potential. Because that's pretty much what we say week in, week out. And I'm not even going to go to letting you know how much my human perfectionism and high self-expectations show up when I'm working on these. So it's like this cacophony of thoughts just sort of whirling around in my head during my week. And truly, my human mind was kind of just feeling overwhelmed and very chaotic around all of this. So anyone got that mind chatter, chaos? A couple, good, okay. So the chatter says one thing I've noticed. It says chaos, it says doubt, it says confusion. But apparently, that thing that connects the dots of life when I can't see what they are, that thing seems to have something other than all that noise in mind. So that greater intelligence, because honest to God, I never would have thought any of this out of my human thinking, that greater intelligence has created a path for me to share more than ever before. And so I figure my job is to get more and more comfortable with the idea that this isn't about the little me wanting to be comfortable and safe and okay. It's about allowing that thing to express itself and its principles of universal living through me. Because the reality is that in the end, something always does show up for me to share, and that's in spite of my misplaced reticence and resistance. And that's really caused me to take pause and to get clear, because it is what is happening. It must be mine to do at this time. And believe me, that is such a much more powerful and connected place to come from than saying, oh, I have nothing to say, I don't want to do it, I don't want things to be like they used to be. So could it be that my destiny really is growing me? And I think it is. And when I use that word destiny, I mean it in the way that Neil Donald Walsh talks about when he talks about that idea of our greatest version of the greatest vision that is our true actualized spirit nature calling itself into expression through us. So I don't mean destiny like fate or predetermination or anything like that. It is our greatest version of who we can be. And, of course, don't you know it, that infinite mind has also gifted me with some really great information as I've been looking at this. And I love the way, if I am open and receptive, the universe confirms me and supports me. So part of this information came through a class that I'm teaching right now called Practical Mysticism. And it's a course I've never taught before. Reverend Diane and I co-teach it. And it is deep and it is different. And in that difference, it's really challenging me because it's presenting a lot of newness. And I noticed that there is some discomfort in the newness. That often seems to be the way that things are. So one of the books that we're studying in the class is Entering the Castle by Carolyn Mace. And one of the things she writes about is that idea of chaos that I talked about, the word that I used to talk about all of this that was going on. And I thought it was so interesting, and I wanted to share a piece of it with you, just in case anybody might be having a little bit of chaos in their lives. I mean, not you, but somebody else. And this is just a very small piece of what she says, and of my very loose paraphrasing as well. So she says that chaos often results from the pull of two worlds, the earthly and the spiritual. And that we can look at it as the hand of the divine pushing us towards change and transformation. And in that, she encourages us to use any chaos, any blah, 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 as a signal that's in the dictionary, right? Blah, 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 blah. To use it as a signal to open, remind us to open to our internal guidance and to use it as a nudge to go beyond our personal point of view of what we think is right or wrong, fair or unjust, to use it as a reminder that there is a divine purpose moving through our lives and through us, so that instead of fighting or resisting the chaos that's going on, to actually use it and to ask, to listen, and to act using it as a messenger that is helping us to move forward into our greater good experience. She does kind of close that section, though, by warning us to be aware that sometimes our minds are very tricky and we might actually have a tendency to keep things kind of messy and chaotic, because then we kind of let ourselves off the hook and say, well, it's just, oh, too much. I can't get a handle on it. So, and then we don't do anything about it. So just a caveat on that. So let's bring this around to all of us. So is there something that seems uncomfortable or hard for you that life is seemingly calling you to? So something that's presented that maybe you don't really love it right now, but something that you can't not do Do you maybe have a vague sense of something that feels unclear, or you're not yet sure what it is or how to move toward it, but you can tell from what's being placed before you that there is growth in it? So just maybe your destiny is calling you to take a step along its pathway. In this teaching, especially with having Dr. Ken as one of our teachers, we talk a lot about the importance of having a vision. And for sure, that idea of having an idea of that greater something serving as a grappling hook for us to move toward is really, really important. But maybe sometimes we forget that to get to that high and lofty place, we need to start where we are with what we have, with what's in front of us now. And maybe some of the things that might be presenting themselves to us are a result of that greater than our human mind, that infinite mind of spirit coming through us, giving us some small steps towards that greatest vision of our greatest version of who we are. And this is pretty wise of that greater mind, because even though it is infinite and we are part of that infinity, it could be a challenge if maybe where we are now is like a 2 and where we want to go is a 10. It could be a challenge to go straight from the 2 to the 10 without moving through the 3s, 4s, 5s and all of that. And I think it makes sense that the mind of destiny, which is offering us that best future, would start smaller than the whole enchilada, to give us the opportunity to work with what we can work with, from where we are, with what we have, and with what is presenting in our lives right now. It's kind of like that idea that an acorn starts a tree. The tree doesn't just appear magically. It's not an instantaneous big old tree. It comes out of that seed, which is the beginning of all things. The seed that we water, that we plant, that we nurture, and then come the roots that hold that tree in a stable way. And this is the same for us as we work toward our tree, that desired outcome, with the steps that are presented to us, and we take care of them and we build on them. And from those, we create stability so our greater can emerge from them. Where you are now, what you're doing with your thoughts, your feelings, and your life is creating the foundation for that future you to be expressed. And I've mentioned this a lot already, and don't worry, I'm going to be over it pretty soon. But how celebrating the 20th anniversary of the center has given me so much opportunity to reflect back, and particularly with that theme of past, present, and future. And it's really caused me to recognize that the universe will not let anything stand still. It just won't. Well, it will, but there's usually a lot of resistance and constriction in that. Anyway, looking back over the years, I can see where we have created a really strong root system here. You know, that's our history and our base. We have a great trunk, which is our ministers, our board, and our leadership, and all the people who volunteer in service here at the center. And we have some really great branches, which are things like our classes, our ministry of practitioners, our events, and our outreach programs. So we have a really solid foundation, and it has served us well and will continue to serve us well as our tree here moves through its growth and its destiny as a divine idea, which is a spiritual community in the mind of the One. And I absolutely know that that destiny will continue to grow us together, and it'll be in some ways that we're used to, which is providing a place where everyone is welcome and everyone can belong, a place that we can practice new insights and skills, and really a place where we can be soul companions for each other on the pathway. And it's also going to be in some ways that are part of our greater yet to be. So one of our newer branches is our Transformative Education Institute, which has just taken a new step towards its vision, and its vision is transforming lives through actualizing potential. And that new piece is our brand new children and youth programs. So we have a new curriculum, we have new teachers, and we have new formats. And this, those steps are paving the way toward becoming an actual school that will provide kids with education that is about nurturing them in body, mind, and spirit. That's a big deal, a big, big deal. And who knows what's beyond that? Because for sure, if we aren't moving forward, we are standing still. So, back to you. What is your next piece? What is that for you about revealing the moreness of who you are? Many of you saw, and I mentioned it last week, the skit that Ken and I did a couple of Sundays ago, which was really a satire and a takeoff of the early days of the center. And that was a leap for me, because I'd never done anything sort of outside my safety zone before. I was so aware that I could have so easily talked myself out of it. If I thought too long or too hard, I could have said, oh, don't make a fool of yourself. It's just silly. But something in me just kind of said, do it. And I think it was because it kind of came in a flash of inspiration. It was really kind of beyond, it felt beyond my human thinking. And I thought, you know, I'm just going to go with it. And so even though, I mean, it was a teeny thing. But you know what I figure is I now have the experience where I tried something that for me was uncomfortable. And it kind of worked. So maybe the next time I might be tempted to pull back or to avoid something because of fear, I just might step out again because I've actually built a little shelf of faith to put my foot on to move forward. And I think just maybe, oh, please, yes, might be happening here in these Sunday talks. And what I'm learning is if I look at them as my opportunity to feel my destiny growing me, they are so much more productive and easier to handle than listening to that, oh no, I'm not even going to go there again. Ernest Holmes, the founder of this spiritual philosophy, said, there is something within me, within us, which goes before us and makes and prepares the way, making it perfect, making it immediate and instant and permanent and harmonious in every situation. It's going before us. We can trust it. We can use that oil of faith that Melody referred to in that creative thought treatment to move us into that. My friend Reverend Keith Cox ends all of his emails with the line, "Here we grow again." And for sure, I know in order for me to grow, I have to move out of my comfort and to do the things that are presented on the path. And so I'm choosing to look at them from the point of view of expectation and anticipation, knowing that it is the work of the divine through me and that the life force puts nothing before me except opportunities to transform and evolve. And I, or we, can either resist those or we can use them as a tool to move forward. And you know, this isn't the first time I felt this way, and it's not likely to be the last one. But what I've discovered is when I bear with it and follow through, my life does keep getting better and better. If I resist or fear or balk, my life kind of stays the same. Only quite often it's more uncomfortable than before. So I'm choosing to grow because from that place of growth, I get ever more closer to the trueness of my being and move to a place where I can celebrate my life rather than just abide in the experience of it. And that's what I choose for anybody who wants to join me. So bless you for being here today. It's a wonderful thing and I so appreciate you. Namaste. Mm-hmm.